Page 2 presents Tell Me More About That, Solving the Empathy Crisis, One Conversation at a Time. Written and narrated by Rob Volpe, with additional narration provided by Billy Joe Cones, David White, Derek Prelo, Jair Bush, Janine Kane, John Duffin, Lisa Costello, Margie Shrimpton, Marquise Moore, Mel Kahn, Mike Carnes, Mike Christensen, Natalie Stanfield, Paul Stefano, Rex Anderson, Robin Thompson, Ryan Rodericks, Stephen Coghill, Stephen George, Susan Fouché, Tim Phelan, Tina Dietz, Tom Maley, and Tom Spath. Dedication. This book is for those curious to understand and courageous enough to try. And for my husband, Charles, who both inspires me and keeps me grounded every day. Introduction. Maya Angelou wrote, "We must support each other and empathize with each other because each of us is more alike than we are unalike. I think we all have empathy. We may not have enough courage to display it." I was not born an empathy guru, but just like every human being, I was born empathetic. Through a combination of genetics, parenting, and lived experiences, I've developed a strong ability for cognitive empathy to see the world from another person's perspective and to walk a mile in their shoes. I also have a gift for insight into human behavior, including my own, which allows me to decipher problems and make the solutions relatable. By trade, I am a market researcher. That means I get to listen to people and their stories. It's a job where empathy skills are critical to success. Over the course of my career, I've met thousands of individuals. These are everyday people, the ones you interact with every day. The people behind us in line at the store, or next to us at the stoplight, or in front of us at the movie theater. The people we don't necessarily give a second thought to when we pass them on the street. They aren't influencers on social media with millions or even thousands of followers. They haven't been on a reality show, nor have they been on the news. For what it's worth, these are normal people. And I am one of those people. I'm sure when I'm standing in line, no one gives me a second thought, just as I don't always give them a second thought. And there are over 332 million of us in the United States. Each one of us is someone else's overlooked person on the street. We are our own counterparts, neighbors and coworkers, residents of the same communities, and we all have our own story to tell, if only we took the time to ask each other the questions, listen to the stories, and see us for who we are. And that's what makes me love what I do. I get to be that person. I get to build empathy with people by asking questions, listening to their stories, and seeing them for who they are and their perspective on the world. And then, for some icing on the cake, I get to share those stories with my clients to get them inspired to take action on that one big idea that'll move their business forward. The projects that my firm Ignite 360 handles involve what may, to an outsider, seem like the more mundane, everyday parts of our lives, like snacks. Yes, snacks. Our clients are fascinated with why you buy what you buy, or what needs you may have that will inform future new products. It's serious work with high stakes. The impact of our thinking, finding insights by building empathy with consumers and turning it into strategy, can mean hundreds of millions of dollars in additional revenue for our clients. The bonus is that, in the course of interviewing someone to find out how they think and feel about snacks, we're also getting to know them, who they are as a person, and what motivates them in life. Will the nation heal its wounds and come together through a shared love of a salty snack or a breakfast cereal? Probably not. But when any two people get in a room together and talk, we do get to know each other better. And that understanding is what will help us come together again, one conversation at a time. Empathy, and a knack for storytelling, is my superpower. It's how I'm able to connect with people and understand where they are coming from. It provides me with the vision to see the world through someone else's eyes. Everyone has their own worldview made up of individual, unique combinations of factors that create their perspective. By listening and adapting a shift in my own perspective to temporarily align with someone else, I'm able to reach cognitive empathy with another person, which forges that connection through understanding. Unfortunately, empathy skills are at an all-time low in the United States and have been since the start of the 21st century. A study from the University of Michigan's Institute for Social Research, which published in May 2010, found, by conducting a meta-analysis of student life surveys from 1979 to 2009, that there was a 40% decline in the ability of students to see the point of view of their classmates in 2001 compared to previous decades. In a study that Ignite 360 conducted in March 2021, nearly one-third of American adults over the age of 18 had no strong feelings toward or disagreed with the statement, "It's easy for me to see the point of view of others." These numbers, while disappointing, should come as no surprise when you consider the state of our discourse, in person as well as on social media, on almost any topic, including politics, religion, gender identity, racism, immigration, policing, welfare, and other social equity issues. The evidence of our decline in empathy surrounds us 24/7. Lack of empathy is generating tension as each side digs in their heels instead of working together towards solutions. This breakdown is the empathy crisis. The empathy crisis is wearing away at the gears in society, grinding us down to nubs, inhibiting our ability to enjoy life. The range of a person's ability to empathize is increasingly limited to the bubbles of their individual lives and belief systems. This breakdown shows up in our resorting to trolling, bullying, and cruelty toward others in order to feel safe and justified in our own attitudes or beliefs, rather than expressing compassion. And forget about finding forgiveness. That's another action that's hindered when there is no empathy. The breakdown is happening both at work and at home. In the workplace, empathy helps with collaboration among teams, improved leadership ability, understanding and relationships with employees, and decision-making. The EQ, or emotional intelligence, expectation of employees and leaders has increased precisely because empathy skills have declined. At home, in the midst of an increasingly diverse population, there's also an increasingly divided culture. We're cheering on division instead of celebrating diversity. Whether we're divided by race or religion, political affiliation, income, privilege, or any other difference, we've lost touch with the ability to be good neighbors. Instead, people disregard the diversity that makes us strong as a nation and have reverted back into segregated tribes aligned with the different sides of the culture wars. Segregating us further and hastening the decline of our empathy skills are our technological advances, which haven't truly shrunk the world, but actually have shrunk us, creating greater distance between us than ever before. Ironically, the biggest divide is with the people we used to be most connected to, those people around us in our community, our neighbors, the ones walking past us on the street, the everyday humans. Compounding the effect of this segregation is the desire of many Americans to be seen as being noteworthy. Perhaps this is a revised American dream, where having greater value than your parents or prior generations is now defined by followers and likes rather than moving up the socioeconomic ladder. Collectively, many Americans have convinced themselves that they must be showcasing an always on-the-go, fabulous life on social media in order to be legitimized, receiving validation from others, and therefore have that greater value. The validation is coming in the form of little blue thumbs-up icons or hearts signifying likes. The more likes, the more validation, which sets off the dopamine in the brain, creating a desire for even more likes the next time. This forms a habit of living life in pursuit of likes. This addiction to validation has squandered the available time that was previously used to form connections casually, like over the fence with the neighbor, or with the adjacent table in a restaurant, or the neighboring pew in church. How often do you now look at your phone instead of striking up a conversation? We've squandered opportunities to build empathy with each other, and as a result, our ability to empathize has atrophied. Now, people bump into one another. Instead of expressing understanding, we're raging at each other, all because we aren't taking the time to pay attention, listen, and see another's point of view. And then, a virus came along and upended everything. COVID-19 forced many of us to live life full-time inside of our own homes. The exciting adventures once posted and validated in the past were replaced, at least in my feed, by pictures of sourdough bread, sunsets from the backyard, and finally, people getting vaccine shots. Since many of our lives had become so routine and similar to each other, our FOMO, fear of missing out, and quest for validation dissipated. Amid the illness, death, and disruption of the pandemic, people were given an opportunity to reflect on their lives and who they wanted to be when the pandemic was over. I was surprised to find, in another Ignite 360 study called Navigating to a New Normal, which gathered data from more than 37,000 adults between April 2020 to March 2021, that 72% of American adults wanted some form of change in their life instead of going back to life as it was pre-pandemic. But what type of change are they wanting? Diving into that data, I was also surprised when we found that of those people looking for change, 74% were looking to have more gratitude and appreciate the things that they have. A major insight coming out of the data was people's desire for connection and community, and to do so in a more meaningful way. That includes 65% of people who said they wanted to make an effort to understand the point of view of other people. They identified empathy as an area they wanted to change or had changed already. That's a lot of interest in building empathy skills. Perhaps you're one of those people, and that's why you picked up this book. The more time I spent thinking about empathy, what it is, how we give it and get it, and why, I've realized that empathy really is like a muscle to be trained and exercised until it's toned and in shape, fit and firm. Currently, many of us have empathy muscles that are flabby and atrophied. Isn't it time to get them back in shape? Tell Me More About That is based on my personal journey toward understanding my own empathy superpower and making my empathy muscle stronger. In the course of this journey, I've gone from being a victim, where I felt people didn't have empathy with me, to learning to dismantle my own judgment and biases so I could truly hear the stories being told to me and achieve empathy with others. Many of these realizations came about in my adventures meeting everyday people while I was doing marketing research projects. In this audiobook, I'll share a selection of these experiences and the lessons that I learned. Meanwhile, I recognized and grew frustrated that more and more leaders and commentators were calling for us as a society to have more empathy. At the same time, clients were asking my firm, in increasing numbers, for empathy engagements so they could get closer to their customers and get some empathy. If empathy is an atrophied muscle, then we need a training plan, a way to strengthen a skill gone soft. But no one had stepped forward with instructions on how to do that. At Ignite 360, we're big on the application of insights, how to put knowledge into action. Without that, our insights are just data sitting around gathering dust. Similarly, I didn't see the value in creating an empathy engagement between a client and their consumer if they weren't going to actually reach empathy. The experience wouldn't turn into something of lasting value. What I recognized was missing was the knowledge on how to reach empathy in the moment of engagement that could be taught to others. Due to my personal experiences growing up, the thousands of people I've interviewed, and being insightful about how my clients and I respond to those people, as well as conversations with a psychologist to help inform my thinking, I've been able to identify the 5 steps that get us to cognitive empathy. My goal is to help you understand the 5 steps to empathy and how to apply them to your own life, whether at work, at home, or at play. I start with a few stories from before I was as well-versed in empathy as I am now and the near disasters that created. Then, I share the 5 steps to empathy. Each step is brought to life in the context of some of my most memorable moments interviewing people, where barriers to empathy came up relevant to that particular step and how I overcame those obstacles. As you listen to these stories, consider how you would react if you...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.